Let us learn about the serialization and deserialization. See, now what happens is that when you create a class, you may create an object for that particular class. And once you close the class or once you execute the program and terminate the program, the object is destroyed by itself. What happens that if you want to call that class without recreating the object, in those cases what you do is that you use the serialization concept where you convert your data into byte stream. So what a serialization say is that it is a process of converting the object in your sequence of bytes, and these sequence of bytes are then stored in a disk or any database and then moved to any other database which is calling this byte streams. And now when you want to convert these stream of bytes back to an object reference, then you call the process as deserialization. Again repeating, why do you need this? When you have already created an object for a class and you don't want to create again the object for that class but still would want to call the data of that class, then you use the concept of serialization, where a serialization is the process of converting your data into a sequence of bytes. That is nothing but stream of bytes, and then converting back from stream of bytes to an object is nothing but your deserialization. And then any class that is trying to implement this serialization or deserialization concept should implement the interface called java.io.serializable or its subclass called java.io.externalizable interface. So these interfaces are used or to be implemented if you want to use the concept of serialization or deserialization. Then it says that a JVM is independent process. That is nothing but, as the main thing that we have learned about our Java, the feature is that it is platform independent. It is the same thing. It says that if you have serialized your class at one stream at one place, you can deserialize at somewhere else. It is not necessary that you do both the serialization and deserialization at one place. Next, it says that the object input and object output streams are mainly used. These are the classes. These are mainly used if you are working on serialization and deserialization. So the first example is on serialization class. We have provide the package java.io. You can write dot serialization. We have just dot io and then asterisk. It means that all the classes that falls under io package will be used in your this particular class. You have created a class called serialization, and then under the main method you have provided certain data where you are getting from your employee class, and then you are trying to get the data in your object output stream, and then use the write object method of serialization, that is of your object output stream, and then store it in your byte stream. Now you are trying to store the object, that is E. E is your object here, right? So E dot name, E dot address, that is you are trying to store the data, that is Monica Mittal and Hyderabad, to your object, that is E. And now this object will be then converted into your object output stream. It will be converted in your input stream. So let us execute this program in practical to understand how the serialization concept works. In this case, we have created an employee class, and our motive here is to convert this object into a stream of bytes and then store it in a location that can be accessed in future at anywhere. That is, it says that as we know that Java is platform independent, it allows you to serialize the object in one platform and then deserialize the object in another platform. So, in order to serialize, or if you want a class to be serialized, that is if you want an object to be serialized into an object streams, that is a stream of bytes, then you need to implement a serializable interface. So, we have first imported the package, that is java.io.serializable. This serializable interface is available in your IO package, which supports the input and output operation of your streams. We have then created a class called EMP, and this EMP class implements the serializable interface, right? So while we are implementing this employee class with this particular interface, because we want this object
to be converted into stream of bytes, right? So the class or the object that you want to be converted into a stream of bytes, you need to implement the serializable interface. So in this class, then we have defined two variables, both of them string type. One is of name and the other one which holds the address. So now we have created a serializable class. Again, in that we have imported the package IO package which has the serializable interface in it. In this class, under the main method, we are trying to instantiate the employee class, the class that you want to serialize. So we have created or we have instantiated the employee class, and then with the help of this instantiation, we will provide the value of each of the variable, and it holds a variable as name and address. Therefore, we provide the value for this employee.name and employee.address. Now, this employee object holds the information about these variables, that it holds the data about the name and address. And now what we want is that we want to convert this object into a stream of bytes. And this stream of bytes, in case of serialization and deserialization, it is recommended to use object output stream and object input stream. Why? Because we are trying to convert the object. Therefore, it is recommended to use an output and an input stream of object type. So, and it is always recommended if you are using or doing any input and output operation of streams, it is always recommended to provide under the try catch block. So under the try block, first we create a file output stream and we say that the file is available here. Please, whatever is the data, go and print or go and write into this particular file. And in this file, how it will be written? This is an object type. If you had to directly provide a string of characters, then you could have directly written system.out.println, or you could have written out.write and then the data that you wanted to print in this particular file. But here you're trying to print or you're trying to copy the data of a particular object to a file. Therefore, you need to use an object output stream. You write object output stream. You create its instantiation, that is, you create its object reference equal to new, its constructor name, and in its constructor, you pass the parameter of the file. That is, this file name, this file name is stored in this particular object. Now, you have two things. You have a file where you want to write, and how will you write to this file? Through object output stream. Now, you need to call the method over these object output stream, and the method is write object. Normally we used to call a write method in order to write a string of characters or data to your file directly, but here you're trying to write an object to a file. Therefore, you need to call a method called write object, which is available in object output stream class. So this write object will take the parameter of value, what object do you want to write. We are trying to write employee object, therefore you pass employee. And where are you trying to write? From which class? Out class. So out.write object. So once you complete or finish writing the object, you need to first close your object output stream, then the file output stream, and then if you want to display any successful message, you can print that. And finally, after this, you write in catch if there is an IO exception or file not found exception or any kind of an exception that you think, you can write it here. So let us execute this program. And as it says that serialized data is saved in cat.txt file. So your this data should be saved here. So let us go here. E drive, files, and your character. If you see, you have here Hyderabad and Monica Mittal. That is, the name and the address is stored. And why you don't understand this is because it is storing in stream of bytes. And now if you want to read this data in a readable format, you have to use the concept of deserialization.
The next one is deserialization. We have already now seen how you can convert an object data into a byte stream, and then how will you store for your future access. But now when you want to retrieve or when you want to display the output, you have to convert these input streams, the byte streams, into your object type, and that is possible through your deserialization. So we have created a class called deserialization, and in the main method we have provided the details for the employee class as null, and with the help of input stream we will read that data, that is in dot read object, because we are converting the byte stream into object type, and then you are storing it in your object. That object is nothing but EMP. So let us execute this program in practical to understand how can you deserialize the objects, the input streams or the stream of data or the sequence of data into an object type.
So let us now see how you can deserialize the object that you have serialized in your previous example. So in order to deserialize, again first you need to import the java.io package, because this package provides you the streaming files, streaming classes, that is your input stream, file input stream and object input stream. So first we have created a class called deserialization. In the main method we say that this method or this class, now this class that you have written may throw certain exceptions. It may throw an exception like IO exceptions, class not found exception. If you remember in a previous video we have written try catch block, and in the catch block you have written what kind of an exception it may throw, like an IO exception. And the other way, if your class is throwing an exception, to handle those exceptions you can write it here with the help of throws keyword. You write IO exception, comma, class not found exception, and if there is any other exception you can write by separating with commas. Now in this particular class we have first declared the object as null. We say that our employee class, our employee object is holding a value null. Why? Because we will be defining later in our try block. So first we say that we are trying to read the file. Which file is that? That is char.txt. And how do you read? You write file input stream, you create its object and new file input stream. That is, you are trying to read from this particular file. And because this file has a data of an object type, then again you use object input stream to read the data from this file. Right? So object input stream in equal to new object input stream, and in its parameter you provide the file object. The next step would be, you have the data. From where you have the data, you have the file, you know how to read. In this particular file you have a data which needs to be read or read with the help of object input stream class, because the data is of object type. And when the object when the data is of object type, you call the read object method. Remember, normally in order to read the data we used to call read method in order to read normal string of characters. Because the data is of object type, you call the read object method, and this read object method you're calling on this in object reference of your object input stream class. So you write the object reference name dot read object. Now you know you have to read the data and you have to store it in some object, because the data that you are receiving is of object type, and when you want to print it, you have to print it from object. That is, for an example, you have one container and that container holds certain information, and in order to print the values or print the elements that is there in that container, you have to retrieve that and store it in a place where it can hold. That is, a container can hold the value of another container. You cannot simply hold or keep the value somewhere else. The container should be of a size which can hold the value of all that values that is there in that particular container. So you call in.read object, and then you need to store this object value in an object. And what kind of an object will you store? This value which is there in this particular file is of employee object type. Therefore, you hold the value of one container in the same type of a container. That is, you hold the value of an object in the same type of an object. And this object, the value that you are trying to read, is of an employee class type. Right? So that is what you are defining. Instead of defining here null, if you want, you can define it here as well. You can write it as employee class you're creating an object type of an employee class, and this value that is stored is of employee type. That is nothing but you're typecasting the value. You're typecasting the value that is there in this particular file with an employee type. And then finally, you close your object input stream, then file input stream, and then finally you say, please print the value that you have provided, right? So here we say that please print this value, and finally you say this is deserializing an employee, that is whatever value you have stored as an object streams, now you are deserializing, that is this deserialization can be done in any other platform, right? So the first name of employee you are trying to retrieve from where? From this particular object reference where the data is stored. So you write employee.name and employee.address. So let us execute this program. And now it says deserializing. The first name is Monica Mittal and the last name is Hyderabad. See, again, you have not provided any such details as Monica Mittal or Hyderabad here. But these details were pulled out with the help of deserialization. That can be done in any other platform.